like to welcome everybody this afternoon to our commissioners' meeting. And Ms. Smith is calling Mr. Smith. He is not with us today. Again, he's still in training out of state, but will join us shortly.
Good afternoon.
Hi, Mr. Smith. It's Gary Schmidt. Are you ready for the meeting?
I'm sitting here watching the video, too.
Okay, good. Okay, we'll now have the invocation given by Dr. Ricky Frazier and then the Pledge of Allegiance.
Let us so kindly bow our heads for a moment of prayer. Precious and almighty and everlasting God, our Father, we thank you again for this privilege and opportunity that you allowed us to come together once again. We thank you, God, for the county commissions who have gathered, the staff and all of the citizens of our county. We ask, God, that you bless us as we go forth to deliberate on business that is concerning us. So, God, we thank you for what you've done for us in the past and what you would do for us in the future. In Christ's name we pray, and for his sake, amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Any additions to the agenda this afternoon? Sure.
We'd like to add a presentation from Dodd and Kovaskis on the coal ash issue.
So, item B on old business, will that work?
Yes.
Okay,
yes,
so we'll just do B and move everything else down.
Thank you.
Anything else?
Madam Chair, where is that presentation going to be in the agenda?
It's going to be item B under old business.
Thank you.
We're going to remove the existing item B.
No.
You want to table that for today? Okay, so that will be tabling item B and the new item B under old business will be a coal ash presentation. Anything else?
Move to approve the amendment agenda.
Second.
Any discussion?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Okay. Approval of consent agenda. Discussion?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Okay. Public comments this afternoon?
I wanted to.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Item H.
Oh, okay. Okay, I'm sorry. We pull item H and defer to Commissioner Reeves.
Members of the board. Unfortunately, I'm going to have to read this resolution. We're losing one of our media folks, one of the kindest media individuals I know personally. Ms. Margaret Murchison is going to think about retiring. if you'll come forward, I'll read this resolution that we have to offer you. It reads, I hope you all can hear me. Lee County Board of Commissioners, resolution of appreciation honoring Mrs. Margaret Murchison for dedicated service to Lee County. Whereas Margaret Murchison was born and raised in Sanford, Lee County, graduated from W.B. Winter High School in 1966, attended Central Carolina Community College and Sand Hills Community College, and received a communications degree through a distance learning program while working full-time. And whereas Margaret Murchison is married to Fred B. Murchison, Jr., and the mother of one son, Fred III of Greensboro. And whereas Margaret Murchison began employment at radio station WWGP WFJA as their news and public affairs director in 1978. And whereas Margaret Murchison served two terms on the Lee County Board of Education and the Central Carolina Community College Board of Directors, and currently serves as president of Brick Capital CDC, the W.B. Wicker Alumni Association, the Enrichment Center Board, and Council for Effective Actions and Decisions, among other numerous boards and committees. And whereas Margaret Murchison has been a role model for many citizens and participated in various activities throughout the city, county, and state, and is a community activist as an advocate for youth and senior citizens. And whereas Margaret Murchison will retire at the end of December from WWGP WFJA with 36 years of service, and whereas it is the desire of the Lee County Board of Commissioners to recognize the many achievements of Margaret Murchison and to express its appreciation for her dedicated service and significant contributions to Lee County. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Lee County Board of Commissioners that it congratulates Margaret Murchison for a career of public service, which has been characterized by a genuine interest in and concern for Lee County, and it wishes her continued success in all her future endeavors. Dated and presented this 15th day of December, 2014. Robert Reed, the sponsor, and Ms. Amy Darumpa, the chair.
But I'm not going home completely. I have to work for a little while longer too. Lee County is doing too many exciting things, so I can't just go home and forget it. I gotta work a part-time job part of the time. But it's been quite a ride, and I plan to put it in book form of these 36 years and all the things that I have experienced. And I don't know how many of you have read that book, The Spook Who Sat by the Door, but I like to refer myself as actually have to listen. I can listen to three scanners, but still know what's going on around me. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Mark.
Thank you.
Thank you, Margaret. Okay, public comments this afternoon. The first would be Mr. William Cole. And as you come to the mic, if you please state your name and your address, please. Thank you.
William Cole, 3021 Foggy Mountain Loop, Sanford. I'd like to thank you all for giving us the opportunity to speak before you. The matter I'd like to discuss most is the concealed carry that y'all are going to discuss again tonight. Public safety is always a concern for everybody involved. And it doesn't matter how large our police force is, they're never a second away when you truly need it. My next point on this is during the Sanford Herald's discussion during the election time, Mr. Tim Sloan made a comment that when they were discussing this particular bill being recalled by the previous commissioners, that he said, you know, this time next year you could be in the Civic Center sitting next to somebody with a gun and you can't trust them. My question is, why can I not be trusted? I'm a veteran of the United States Army. I've owned a firearm since I was 8 years old. I've never incidentally or intentionally shot anyone. So what have I done to not be trusted? I don't have a felony. And the worst thing I've got is a speeding ticket, and I haven't had one of them in 20 years. So why can I not be trusted? I've gone through everything the law requires to have a concealed carry permit, fingerprinted, the whole nine yards. Why am I not to be trusted? Next one. It was, according to your last meeting, y'all had surveyed the county employees and that they didn't feel comfortable by recalling that bill either, allowing people to conceal carry. The employees are not employed by the commission. The commission was elected to represent us, the voting citizens. I think you need to keep that in mind, along with the fact that it's our constitutional right. Signs that sit on the door like today, they affect people like me. There's a sign on the door, therefore I have no weapon. I did not carry it. I would not try to violate that law because I, once again, am a law-abiding citizen. Now, someone who has intent to do any harm to any individual is not going to stop at the sight of a sign. Not going to happen. They're going to say, somebody has made them mad, and they're going to go, it doesn't matter if they're just going to physically assault them, not even necessarily shoot them. A sign saying you cannot assault somebody in this building will not stop them. They're not going to see the sign, turn around, go back to their car, and say, well, I have to wait till later. The signs don't stop anybody but law-abiding citizens. The next one. If we're not allowed to carry into our county buildings, is there going to be armed guards in all the parking lots to ensure our safety? As much as I love this country, it's gone down rapidly. I don't carry with hopes of getting the opportunity to pull my firearm. I carry with hopes that I never in my life have to use it to defend myself. I don't expect to use it. I don't expect to ever have to use a fire extinguisher, but I carry one in my vehicle. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cole. Mr. Jimmy Douglas.
He made every point I was going to make.
Oh, okay. Thank you, sir. Mr. Mark Coggins.
Mark Coggins, 3909 Hunt Springs Drive. Thank you for letting me talk to you about the concealed weapons ordinance that you're going to reinstitute. My idea is to have law enforcement officers walk through the county and city offices as well as other county facilities. This way the employees, the public, will see that there are armed officers that will be walking through and around the facilities. Better to have trained officers with weapons who have been trained to handle various situations than someone just to carry a weapon into a workplace and someone just arbitrarily shooting around where there may be children, such as social services, the OT Sloan Park, or Stanley Park. There was an instance in Stanley Park this summer where me and my grandkids went to a party. After being there about 15, 20 minutes, a gentleman walked up with an arm, Glock 9 on his hip. I told my children, I said, let's leave. And they said, why, Grandpa? I said, well, we can't outrun a bullet. So therefore, we skipped the party. But I think that if we have these armed officers, it would also get them out of their patrol cars, meeting the public, the employees of the county and the city, and also bring about better relationships between the officers and the public. Thank you so much for letting me.
Mr. Andy Stevens.
I think I brought a copy of this. I previously emailed it to the commissioner.
Good afternoon, Andy Stevens, 2109 Leona Drive, Greensboro, North Carolina, representing Grassroots North Carolina here today, which is also the celebration of Bill of Rights Day, by the matter, commissioners. 2 months ago, Lee County commissioners, like others, took a look at a 20-year-old outdated ordinance and repealed it. Created in January 1995 as a knee-jerk reaction to the passage of legal concealed carry, local politicians across the state responded in fear with ordinances to ban the practice. Today, however, 20 years later, and 400,000 concealed carry permit holders and growing, even the general public recognizes these fears of lawful citizens exercising their rights and privileges were unfounded. Concealed carry permit holders have demonstrated themselves safe, sane, and sober in their conduct. And as a recent Pew survey indicates, Americans overwhelmingly now agree. The previous Lee County Commission wisely agreed as well. However, a new liberal majority within minutes took action to turn lawful citizens back into criminals and boasted their intention to make everyone entering a Lee County building a victim. Yes, a victim. In two county commission meetings, you now acknowledge that Lee County buildings are teeming with crime. Why does this new liberal majority want victims? Well, the answer is simple. Liberals believe victims turn to government the end-all solution to all things. In return, you'll only ask for two things of us, our freedom and our money. For, of course, it will require enormous sums of money to fix the problem on your terms. The federal and state constitution are not just words on paper with no meaning. Saturday, gun-owning patriots in Washington state provided an example to politicians taking our rights. Your vote, if you confirm this today, may very well lead to a similar expression. In four meetings now, you have heard from scores of citizens not to take the action you plan to take today, but you do not listen. Your day of reckoning, like Washington State's, will come. In the meantime, citizens and visitors to Lee County facilities will necessarily enter at their own risk, fearful of their safety and dependent upon an incompetent, overbearing government pandering to their safety while offering no solution. Peacefully assembling in the streets of Sanford, openly carrying the firearms the Constitution allows us to do, seems like a reasonable next step. While other counties near and far across the state enjoy the fruits of freedom, after today, Lee County residents may not. Let the consequences fall on your shoulders. Grassroots North Carolina will go to the General Assembly in January, using Lee County's action as a blatant example of the need for further statewide uniformity of rights and demand the power of local government be curtailed once again for the arbitrary, capricious, and taking of such rights. In the meantime, we will inform our membership, friends, and business partners to avoid Lee County as a place unfriendly and unsafe to visit or do business within. Open carry demonstrations here may change minds too, so expect that possibility after news of your decision spreads. You do, however, have one last chance to see the light, rescind your action, or prepare to feel the heat. Thank you.
Mr. Stevens, if I may, since it seems like you had that prepared, could you email that to me, please?
The speech?
Yes, sir.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Okay, Mr. Keith Clark.
Keith Clark, 212 Akron Drive, Sanford, North Carolina. I'm not a paid spokesman. Many times we struggle with the right answer to whether the glass is half empty or half full. We might look at the facts. 4 ounces of water in a cup. It does not have to be water, does it? And what kind of cup? This size or this size? What we see as facts are determined by our perception. No matter how many people share a perception, it does not establish the truth. Our Heavenly Father's children cannot do this in mortality. Dr. Martin Luther King understood the plight of America over the issue of race, and no one understood better than he that it was a complex problem and required courage and effort and change and patience. He spoke to all Americans when he said, "One of the most common tendencies of the human nature is that of placing responsibility on some external agency for sins we have committed and mistakes we have made. We are forever attempting to find some scapegoat on which we can cast responsibility for our actions. No matter what our conditions are, no community can move forward until each part assumes all responsibility for the entire problem. Resentments have no color, and when stored too long, create bitterness that locks a person into a self-fulfilling pattern of perception. The crisis that we face is not new. It has simply surfaced again. The Chinese symbol for crisis includes characters for danger and opportunity. What is required of us now is to not let the danger crowd out the opportunity. Let all of us not judge a family by what happens in the time of grief, public grief, especially a public grief they did not choose. And let us, including you special public officials, honor the rights of all, including the right of presumption of innocence. The price of freedom includes patience. Give us an example free of any rush to judgment. In fact, No judgment at all. Next, this is not Ferguson, and we must be sure that the world sees that. Sanford can deal with this crisis. We can deal with this in our hearts, not in our streets. And let's not start a conversation, call a city-county meeting, appoint a task force, call attorneys together, or call any other professionals. We all know this has not helped in the past. Government cannot solve this problem alone. Let communities of faith take the lead. May we use the celebration of the Prince of Peace, whose light is sufficient for every and all problems, to find the path of peace through him. He always blesses all and each. Merry Christmas, and God bless our nation and everyone.
Thank you. Ms. Carol Clarkson.
My name's Carol Carlson. I live at 1814 Holiday Road in Sanford, North Carolina. I don't have prepared remarks, but I would like to make a couple of comments. First of all, I congratulate you all who have recently been elected as our new commissioners. You were elected by the people of Lee County, and we're excited of the opportunities that we see coming. I also want to thank you for the courage that you have shown by modifying the ordinance concerning concealed weapons. I don't have any statistics of horrible things that have happened in our county buildings or in our parks, but I do say that I have a lot of confidence in our sheriff's department and our police department. I do think they respond as the chairperson of our downtown Sanford board, which I am not here today, you know, as a representative of that. But I know that we had a meeting the other day and we asked someone from the police department to come and talked about that maybe there needed to be more presence downtown. They have certainly done that. We are not the Wild West. We are a civilized community. If we don't trust the people that we have to protect us and take care of us, then I think we are in dire straits. I thank you all again.
Moving on to old business, item A, page 47, the second reading of the resolution to modify ordinance concerning concealed handguns on county property. And I will read the resolution. The resolution to amend section 2-31 of the Lee County Code of Ordinances concerning concealed handguns on county property. Whereas NC General Statute 14-415-11 prescribes the rules under which an individual possessing a valid concealed handgun permit may carry such handgun, and whereas NC General Statute 14-41523 gives local governments the authority to determine whether to prohibit by ordinance the carrying of concealed handguns in county buildings and appurtenant premises and on county recreational facilities, and whereas, as passed by the Lee County Board of Commissioners on November 6, 1995, Section 2-31 of the Lee County Code of Ordinances prohibited concealed handguns on county property, and signs indicating such prohibition were posted on county property, and whereas on October 6, 2014, the Lee County Board of Commissioners approved the second and final reading of a resolution to modify Section 231 of the Lee County Code of Ordinances, thereby allowing concealed handguns on certain county property, with such changes to take effect on January 1st, 2015. And whereas it is the desire of this board to modify Section 2-31 of the Lee County Code of Ordinances to prohibit concealed handguns in all county buildings and their appurtenant premises. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Lee County Board of Commissioners as follows. Number one, Section 2-31 of the Lee County Code of Ordinances is hereby modified to prohibit concealed handguns in county buildings and their appurtenant premises and in county recreational facilities as defined by General Statute 14-41523. Number two, the remaining portions of Section 2-31 of the Code of Ordinances concerning prohibition against firearms and prohibition against deadly weapons shall remain in effect as written, with the exception of changing, quote, public-owned buildings, end quote, to, quote, county-owned buildings, end quote. And number three, the county manager is directed to post appropriate signage related to the above modification. First reading, December 1st, 2014. The second reading, December 15th, 2014. Any discussion?
Madam, I wasn't here for the first reading because I was working. I just want to make a couple of points as you consider this. The sheriff can't be everywhere at all times, and we have to acknowledge that. He does a great job. He can't protect us wherever we are at all times. You know, I think our main thing was that, and it's made this comment, employees that didn't want this at the workplace, so you can still make that a part of being employed here in Lee County, is that you don't have to or can't bring a gun to work. But that shouldn't look, you know, you shouldn't stop the residents from being able to conceal carry in the workplace. We don't have a choice of where to go when we want to do business. But county employees have a choice of where they want to work, if that's okay with them not being able to bring a gun to the workforce. I've heard a couple times, and I'm not, you know, I think you even mentioned one time you didn't want people carrying concealed carry because you didn't want it to be the Wild West in here. We have open carry laws in North Carolina, and we have concealed carry. But there's not the Wild West out there. Why all of a sudden is it going to be here? I don't understand it too. But even though we know that less than 0.1% of all legal concealed carry holders ever commit crime, I don't understand the issues. But those are my two cents. And thank you.
Madam Chair, I move to approve this resolution.
Any further discussion? Yes, Mr. Smith.
Is it still open for discussion?
Yes, sir. Yes,
if I may, I want to say thank you to Mr. Stevens for taking his time and coming here to discuss this, and for pointing out that today is, of all days, it's Bill of Rights Day. Back in 1791, on December 15th, this country established a Bill of Rights, in which we as the people have a right to protect our lives, our liberty, and our property. But apparently today, I guess the county commission decides that they can openly detest that. Not only that, in your first meeting, the board ignored a religious liberty, the right to religiously oppose something that they find conscientiously objectionable, and yet no one wanted to sign on to the resolution condemning the two federal judges, but that's another issue. This board has limited the citizens' right to speak and petition by setting the meeting times to 4 o'clock in the afternoon, when it's 6 o'clock, most people can make the meeting.
Mr. Smith, can we please stick to the issue at hand?
It is. It's Bill of Rights Day, and you're violating one of the major rights that we have as citizens, especially the law-abiding citizens. Now, I know this board wishes to appease a very small minority of the county
employees who are fearful of law-abiding citizens, and I find that openly insulting to those citizens. So I just wanted to share with you. Right now, I'm sitting within 1 mile of Arlington Cemetery, and I just want to share with you that your vote for this ordinance is an insult to those sacrifices made to this country. Thank you.
Well, let me say this. There's people sitting on this board that's made sacrifices, and we're going to have a vote in it.
Let me just ask. In his current, I'm talking to you, Commissioner Smith, in your current position, I guess you're down at Fort Bragg. Are you carrying your weapon there?
And that's not the point. That's a federal law, and we're working on opposing that. I'm here to talk about North Carolina and our laws. We do have the right of local control, and we do have the right to establish our own laws, contrary to what the federal government does.
That's what we're fixing to do.
Okay, I understand that.
I'm sorry, I can barely hear.
They're afraid to speak up.
Mr. Stevens. Yes, I do appreciate the citizens of Lee County coming in and weighing in on this. But Mr. Stevens, you're from Guilford County, and Guilford County has the same concealed carry laws that Lee County does. So it really bothers me that you come and interject your 2 cents worth in our county when you haven't taken care of it in your county.
Well, let me ask, have you done that? Have you done that?
I spoke before the Guilford County Commission last Thursday, and they are we have a new commission in place as well, and they are going to take action to change things as well. I will say that in Guilford County in March, we were able to repeal all weapons restrictions in parks and did not put in place any of the lawful prohibitions that you may still, in fact, have in your parks that state law currently allows.
Okay, well, the vote's been called for, but before we do that, I would just like to say it does trouble me that some of the comments that have been made here would leave the public to believe that the entire county, for the most part, except for, as Commissioner Smith said, a small minority, are in favor of allowing concealed carry in our public buildings. And I will say from the conversations and from the communications that I've received that that's not true. And I'm elected to serve the citizens and not a special interest group. And that's why I'm voting today. I do understand people's emotions and people's feelings on both sides. But nobody up here is voting to take your guns away. But we have to have certain rules in a public society. And the federal government adheres to these rules, our state government adheres to these rules. So this county, with all due respect, Mr. Stevens, should not be held up as an example of some backwards place that is taking away your rights. That is not fair. And this board—
You're addressing me the question. You are the only county or jurisdiction to have done so now in the last 4 months.
The laws are still in place. Nothing
Many
was going—
Many do not have a law
sir,
prohibiting—
Sir, excuse me.
Concealed carry.
Have him removed if you can't behave.
It's okay. She's addressing you. Okay, call for the vote. Do we have a motion?
I need a motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Can I be on the record for the note? You didn't ask for the notes.
Oh, I'm sorry. Sure.
You did the right thing because I was going to mark you down as affirmative.
I learned from the best.
Yes, that's right. That's right. Moving along. As a lot of you are aware, we have been up to our eyeballs in coal ash, and we're trying to get a handle on the issue, and we truly are learning more every day. And this board is trying to be as transparent as we possibly can as we learn something and as we understand it. we're trying to pass that along to the citizens. And with that in mind, we've asked Dr.
Go for it.
Excuse me. We've asked Mr. Honorable, yeah, Mr. Honorable Don Kavaskis. He's worked very hard and sacrificed his weekend, and I do appreciate that. To give us a PowerPoint presentation on what we have learned so far about the Colon Road coal ash site.
Yes, on Wednesday, Chara and Duke's open house was very informative. Had a lot of great information, and I was pointed a number of times to the Diener site where we could pull coal ash excavation and disposal. The Colon mine site, their permit application, all the calculations, drawings. And so what I'm going to show you today is taken from the actual permit data itself.
Do we have that document that you just had up there? You didn't pass that out to us?
No, this...
All right, that's all. I just want to make sure.
Okay. It can be downloaded from the internet.
That's fine.
So what I'm going to do first is we're going to look at the actual permit application. Colon mine site structural fill that Chara has submitted. The introduction, I'm going to zoom into that so you can actually read it, or I will actually read it to you, that this is a facility plan to reclaim the Colon mine site located in Lee County, North Carolina, with coal combustion product CCP structural fill. The mine, once completed, will be reclaimed by encapsulating CCPs in line containment in order to reestablish the mine contours to a useful design. That's important to what we're going to be looking at here. And from other sources, mine reclamation is the process of restoring land that has been mined to a natural or economically usable state. And that's what I'm reading in the introduction here. So this is their facility plan and buffers, Chara Sheet C2. It actually shows the property and the cell area where the reclamation will take place. And I'm going to zoom into that. We can see that there's five cells here, totaling about 118 acres. And what we have done then is we took this data and just rectified it to our GIS so that we have a good idea of where this is at. I'm going to back out then and look at the whole site. The red is the 400 plus acres, and the yellow is the cell, again, where that's going to be reclaimed. Back a few years ago, we rectified all historical ag photos to our GIS, and they just happen to come in handy today. We're going to take a look at some historical data on how the mines progressed in that area. We'll look at 1938. You can see that the areas that the cell, where it's going to be reclaimed, you have some agricultural fields and trees, and the mining was actually done in the southwest of that, just south of that property. 1950, same thing. You've got agricultural areas in the cell, and that you can see where the mine is there in the green. 1955, actually on the 1955 photos, it talks that that's 95% excavated, moved, or altered. Again, it's to the southwest of the property. Same way with 1966, 1972, 1983, 1991. And then we look here in 1999, where the excavation of the clay is across the railroad tracks in the southern part of the 400 and some odd acres. 2005, the mining is actually up into the area that's going to be reclaimed. 2010, it hasn't changed. 2013, it hasn't changed. So if we look at these cells.
May I interrupt one
yes,
second?
Yes, sir.
Back in 72, you had 3 green circles, I thought.
Yes, up in the
left hand corner.
Right there, there was some mining that we could tell was being done. Okay. And actually, if you zoom in close to that photo, it says clay mine.
Okay.
Right on.
Thank you.
So, from a historical standpoint, looking at the mining is what you see here on the cell 1 and cell 2, where you have those clearings. So we're going to, maybe we had missed something. We're going to look at Chara's sheets again, and we're going to zoom in to the middle of those cells to get an idea of what else we're looking at here. You can see that the topographical lines, that is typical of the peaks and valleys in an area of the county that has not been disturbed. We're looking at elevations of 300, 290, 270, 280, 290. And again, these are indicative of areas that have not been mined. So we can see from these cells that cell 1 and cell 2 incorporate about 30% of the area that's going to be reclaimed, where 70% of the area we can see has not been disturbed with any mining activity. So we look at Chara's reclamation plan then, and we're going to zoom into this, and we can see that their end process is going to show an elevation of 330. You got a 2% slope, 320, 310 down to 270. And so what we've done then is we've taken that data, rectified it to our GIS, and now what we're going to do is we're just going to push this picture over on its side. So in the upper right-hand corner, that orange arrow is pointing to the direction from the map that you just saw on how that's going to be. And you can see the normal topology in the cells 4 and 5 there. So we took their elevation for their plan for their reclamation, and that's what we end up having. The large pile to the right there, that is 3,000 feet long and 1,400 feet wide. That's, if you can imagine where you're sitting now, down Carthage Street to the Dolce Vita, to the buggy factory, that's 3,000 feet. 1,400 feet is from here down Vance Street to the old W.B. Wicker School. So we're looking at an area just on the right side, that side. Now we're going to look around from behind it, and you can see that the reclamation plan is bringing it up to grade the highest part of that property, that part of that 400-some-odd acres. And to verify that what we're looking at is accurate, also from their site cross sections, at the very top there you can see the smaller and the larger one, the cross section, and we're going to actually zoom into that so that you can see there's the 280 elevation and the 330, and that's 50 feet in between there. You can see that the top is going to be virtually level. It's only a 2% grade, and you're looking at 1,400 feet-ish. 50 feet, and we can visualize that. This building, 4 stories, it's about 40 feet. 50 feet, Carthage Street, the old furniture building. It's got Shops of Steel Street on the bottom, the radio station. It used to be where Lemoore Oil is located. That's 5 stories, that's 50 feet. So, that's our end game.
So, if I'm understanding what you just said, the majority of the field is going to be above the current topography.
That's correct.
So, how is that called a mine reclamation project?
I'm not an attorney.
That's your question.
Okay.
In the legislation.
All right.
Any more?
part of the county is around 420, but that's in the southwestern part of the county.
Don, these are old clay pits. Has there been any reclamation done beforehand? You know, most cases, if you got a pit, you have, you're required to do a reclamation when you close it.
I couldn't tell. Other than what the aerial photos that show the ponds.
Their reclamation plan on this particular site, the first three ponds on the left when you drive on the site, were just to be left as that, which is acceptable under the mining rules for the state.
So they're holding water?
Mm-hmm.
Well, they reclaimed it was fishy ponds.
Mm-hmm.
Madam Chair, I cannot hear the manager.
Oh, okay.
Sorry. I'm sorry. I'm
it's a little under the weather. He was saying, Mr. Smith, that the reclamation for the ponds out there right now, they're actually fishing ponds, and that sufficed under the permit, correct?
Correct.
Yeah.
Have we ever done a soil study of the soil at the present moment in that area?
Of this?
Mm-hmm.
Before the property was purchased, there was an environmental study done. I don't know the contents of that environmental study.
Can we get it?
The buyers, the purchasers had it done, Chara.
Yeah.
No.
Can we get a hold of it?
We can always ask, but.
It's a private entity.
I don't know that we'll get it.
Yeah, I think there's an issue there I'd like to see.
Okay, thanks.
Any other questions or comments?
Well, I've just got one comment. I mean, we keep hearing that part of the reason they want to bring it here is because of the clay, and when the bulk of the material is going to be above the ground and not protected by the clay other than what's on top of the lining, it kind of concerns me.
I think the bigger concern is that some of that soil is already contaminated. So if there's recontamination, you can't prove it.
And the drainage on it.
You know, we don't have a lot of information on the site itself.
But we are trying to find out. But we are dealing with two private entities. But thank you, Don, very much.
Does that layout meet the definition of reclamation, or in your opinion? If it's too dicey, don't touch it.
I think that's something that needs some further study.
I would hope so.
Yes.
I would hope so.
And again, the frustrating thing is that this, we are getting new information every day. And then having to try to parse that and figure out what it means and the legalities of it. But this just came to light Friday?
Thursday around noon,
right. And so thank you very much, Don, for putting this together, because I'm a visual person. Those charts didn't help me a whole lot, but this does. And it's definitely deeply concerning, because this is not what I envisioned when I was talking to folks at the Arts Center on Wednesday night.
Well, that wasn't a picture they showed either.
No.
My expectation and would have been an inversion of what you see there.
Exactly.
That's the picture that shows, was the inversion.
Right. So hopefully this will prompt some more discussion with Chara as to what their plans are.
Yeah, Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
If I could add, I know that John and I were the only ones that are still here that sat in on that meeting, and we were led to believe it was going to be reclamation and this land could be turned back over to commercial reuse and development, and I'm here to tell you, that looks like a landfill to me.
I agree, Kirk. It's really bothersome when I kind of understand why it was so hard to get a hold of these permits, because I tried to get them online, and I know I talked with the attorney for a while. I was very frustrated for about a week and a half. I couldn't even get them.
And I heard you admit that. So, let me ask you, doesn't this present sort of a two-lane situation? We're dealing with Duke Energy on the one hand, and these folks have their own entity that could very easily slip past the guard if we don't pay close enough attention to who's doing what.
I think the real issue here is, you know, they were given a lot of leeway within the statutes to do something like this. I mean, if you read back over, there's obviously the intent to allow them to store coal ash offsite or whatever, and how they do it. I think they're, after touring the Asheville facility, they filled in quite a bit. They filled in a ravine, and they're going to put a runway and some hangars on some stuff. So I think there's some belief within their handling of it that site could be used commercially. But in Asheville, you have a captive audience. I mean, you have a runway, you have an airport, and someone may be willing to put a hangar on that piece of property. Here, you know, when you have a choice to go a mile or 10 miles up the road to another industrial site, would you go to that site or would you go to the other site? You know, this site, yeah, you're going to have a nice view, but, you know, you... you're gonna people have choices that, you know, Asheville, you know, if you're gonna locate at the airport, you don't have a lot of choices anymore because they've run out of space. So they use the coal ash to reclaim, or not even reclaim, they use coal ash to claim property that was a ravine and gonna put commercial basically hangars on there. So, but I don't know, if I'm an adjoining property owner, do I want to, you know, this is going to be my view now. So I'm sure they're going to have some issues with it and some questions about how it's actually going to look from their property and whether their property is going to hold value or decrease in value because of that.
In the past, establishing a pit, you filed for your permit, you submitted your own reclamation plan, and they approved it or disapproved it. And that's the reason I was asking if this place had ever been reclaimed before. If it's still a hole, of course, you know, you can fill it up. And I'm assuming they're going to have to submit a plan that the state will accept if they're calling it reclamation.
Yes, sir. They're modifying their permit.
Their modification was for the term that I learned last week at the legislative meeting was dewaterization. Is that correct? Of the ponds?
Yes, draining
them.
they have to take the water out.
Yes, but I mean, they call it dewaterization permit, you know, and to drain it. And so, yeah, it's my, like you said, my whole thing was it was going to be an empty hole that they were going to put in. And now that Mr. Kovaskis actually got the numbers from the permit, it doesn't show that.
If you're reclaiming a pit, you can make a you can reclaim a pit and make it look good. And a prime example we have here in the county, Tobacco Road. Mm-hmm. That's old sand pits. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you can, if it's done and done right, you can make it look good. Or
you can have this.
That's right, or you can have this.
Well, and again, this, you know, for the public, this was just for information only today because we've conveyed to the county manager that when we find something out and we can check it as fact, we definitely want to share it with the public. And we're learning as you guys are learning.
Well, I want to thank you, Madam Chair, and the staff for staying on top of it and keeping abreast of. Thank goodness you had what you had in place.
Yes.
We would really be in the dark. I don't know if this is the time we need to discuss where do we go from here in terms of advising the staff, but certainly that ought to be on our agenda pretty soon.
Definitely. We'll be talking about it later. Okay. Thank you so much, John. Science lesson for the day. Okay, Ms. Mary Yao, resolution to delay reappraisal in Lee County.
Good afternoon. At your last meeting, we brought some information to your attention in the form of a sales ratio study that looked at how sales were going in Lee County against our appraised values of properties. And we also discussed with you that we would be bringing a resolution recommending that we delay the effective date of the next reappraisal till January 1, 2019. Would you like me to read the resolution, or if you had a chance to read it?
It's not necessary unless everybody had a chance to read it. Okay.
Basically, it revokes the January 1, 2017 date and delays the effective date until January 1, 2019. And will return us to a 4-year cycle after that.
Any comments or discussion?
So what the public needs to know is the board is fixing the vote so that we do not have a property reevaluation until 2019 at the earliest. I think that's very important for them to understand. And then we will return to a 4-year cycle, and I think that's something that people need to know. When we were told you were given a tax cut in the past, and then your properties were reevaluated, several individuals' taxes went up. And so that's a benefit to the community.
Any other discussion?
Second for the resolution. Someone made a motion.
A
second, yeah.
Okay. All those in favor of the resolution, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Okay, motion passes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Item D under old business, the resolution to accept the bid for property on Stanley Drive. Ms. Kiri Smith.
Yes, if you'll recall at the last meeting, Mr. Woods-Doster brought forth an offer from the estate of Wilma Chesney to purchase property, which essentially would give that property right of way, access to the property. I received no upset bids, so we're going to be courteous to determine if we can sell that property for $100.
Would you accept the bid?
Second.
Okay. Motion made and seconded. All those in favor?
Uh-huh.
All those opposed? Motion passed. Thank you. Okay, new business. Item A, recommendation from Lee County Democratic Party for new Register of Deeds, Mr. John Kirkman.
Good afternoon.
I'm
the first vice chair of the Lee County Democratic Party, and 10 days ago, we met in the courthouse and followed our established procedure. We were satisfied that there was a quorum present, and then we had a vote. And Pamela Britt was overwhelmingly elected by our executive committee and the precinct representatives there. And so we submitted a letter the next day requesting that you honor our election of Pamela Britt to become our new Register of Deeds.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
I move to accept the recommendation of the Executive Party, Democratic Executive Party.
Any discussion?
Ms. Britt in here?
Yeah, she's there. She's here.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
I just wanted to stand so the public could see you. Now we'll vote and then we'll congratulate you.
Okay. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Item B under new business, bid for rehabilitation of one house for the CDBG grant. Ms. Kennedy.
Hey. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
You received today our bid tabulation from the bid opening we had this morning. It's for the last house in the CDBG project. Remember, I came to you a few weeks ago with all the problems we'd had and houses dropping out, so we had to pick one more. We have selected that home. It's on Hayes Road. We took bids today, and we are recommending award of the contract to Compendium Contracting from Sanford, North Carolina. And I explained in my verbiage at the bottom why we were choosing them, and that's truly about time schedules and trying to finish everything in a timely manner.
Okay, any questions or discussion?
Just looked like we had some close bids.
We did.
Yeah, good bids.
Have you used that company before, Karen?
We have. They just had a different name.
It's the name. Okay.
Are you satisfied with that company?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
I mean, all of them we have to keep an extra eye on, so.
Okay, do I hear a motion?
Move to.
Okay. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed?
Aye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Okay, item C, policy for teleconference calls during board meetings. And I guess I'll let our attorney walk us through this, please.
Yes. So the procedure is essentially just a few steps. There are three reasons, according to this policy, the board may choose something different, but there would be three reasons that remote participation would be allowed: personal illness or disability, employment purposes, or family or the other emergency. The person wishing to participate remotely must notify the clerk or the chair ahead of time. The board would then vote to determine whether that person would be allowed to participate remotely. The person participating remotely would not be able to vote on items on the agenda. Furthermore, they will not be allowed to participate in quasi-judicial hearings, closed sessions, or any other official meeting of the board in which there would be anything confidential discussed or anything subject to privilege.
Any questions or comments, discussion?
I've got a couple of just information purposes. Are there limits to the number of times a request can be made for?
There is not in the policy. I think that could probably be accomplished by the board voting to approve whether someone can participate remotely or not prior to that remote participation. But if you would like me to add that in, I certainly can.
At least that comment in there so that we'll know that we have a system in place. And the second one is, it's item C on the second page.
Madam Chair, I can hear nothing.
Okay, I'm sorry, Mr. Smith. We'll try to do better with our microphone.
I haven't said anything yet. I would say in the second, I think it's C, it seems that the policy itself allows for it, so we don't really have, what would be grounds to refuse or reject, if any? And if you don't have it off the top of your head, don't.
You know, I don't have any. This came, North Carolina does not have any case law. There are no statutes
right,
governing this. So I looked outside of North Carolina. Some states have very specific statutes governing this type of participation. You know, there comes, the board has made it known that they don't want constant participation through telephone, through internet, or that. So that would be one way to limit that. But that can certainly be removed. There's no statutory requirement. There's no case law saying that has to be in there.
Okay. And the last one, if they're not going to be allowed to vote, are they allowed to offer motions on subject matters?
No.
Is that spelled out?
No, I will add that.
Okay.
Did you say there would be or not?
There would not be allowed.
I think you could. And my last one. My last one is one that I think each individual will be responsible for, because we don't have a way of checking it. But for example, I know that if a person was present here, anybody can come to a public meeting. I don't know what kind of situation might be conducted in an office or who might be present. So at some point in time, I think it's appropriate if we ask that question. If you're at your office, are there people in the area, just for information purposes?
And there are other jurisdictions that require anyone participating remotely to state that they are alone, that they have people in their
that's,
presence.
That's what I'm driving at. Thank you.
Any other questions, comments? I would like to say, Commissioner Smith, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. We're not picking on Commissioner Smith. This is just something that, just the way the timing fell with his training and our relatively new attorney, and as we started looking through things, we did not have a county policy. And in thinking about all the things that life can throw at you, whether it's, you know, work obligations that you didn't foresee or family illness or your own personal illness, there might be certain specific limited times where we would need to have a policy to address this. So that's what's bringing this up.
I'm glad that we do. Now I'm getting one. Over my years, we didn't necessarily have one. I tried to make as many meetings, and I've got a darn good record I'm proud of. Mm-hmm. But the other side of that is, in each election year, I converse with my employer to make sure that I could make meetings regardless of the time. We had 8 o'clock meetings, we had 9 o'clock, we had 4 o'clock, we had 3 o'clock. So I felt that I had a duty to do some things on my end to make sure that I could participate if I was going to be in an elected position.
Any more discussion? Your motion?
Move to approve.
As
with the,
there were several changes made.
Okay, would you with rather to just?
We would rather, if everybody's okay with the changes, go ahead and rewrite the
okay.
proposal and have it back at the first January meeting, because I don't think we're not on a rush.
You want to amend that motion? Okay. Yeah, I would prefer that as well. But
that would be better for
us. The only time.
Us.
Okay. So
make sure we get it right.
The motion is to table this until our January 5th meeting.
Correct.
Rewritten with advised amendments. Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Okay. Okay, new business, item D, consider voting delegate for January Legislative Goals Conference, Mr. Crumpton.
Yes, ma'am. The North Carolina Association of County Commissioners Legislative Goal Conference will be in Pinehurst on January 15th and 16th, and we need a voting delegate. I do not have the issues yet that you'll be voting on, or whoever that person will be to vote on, but normally we present that at the first meeting in January anyway, so we should have them by then. So, but we do need to appoint a delegate so we can send that to the association. And Gaynell, who's so far said they were going?
Yourself, Commissioner Dalrymple, and Commissioner Fraser.
So either Commissioner Dalrymple or Commissioner Fraser. Typically it's the chair if the chair goes. So.
Sounds good to me. Amy is the chair.
Yeah,
just need a motion.
I take that. Okay, do I need?
You need a motion.
So moved.
Okay, any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. All right, thank you, I think.
Madam Chair, I suggest that we just go ahead and go into closed session so we get this done before 6 o'clock.
Yes, to explain to the public, we have a closed session on the agenda and public hearings with the Planning Board at 6 o'clock. So we will now go into closed session. Need a motion?
Yes. Madam Chair, I move that we go into closed session to consult with the attorney to protect the attorney-client privilege. Per North Carolina Statute 143.318.2 and closed session to consider personnel matter per North Carolina General Statute 143.318.11A6.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, we're in closed session. Thank you, folks.
Thank you.
No worries.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. We're going to reconvene into public session. Ms. Schmidt, could you read out Mr. Smith, please? As everybody comes back in, almost 6 o'clock. And Ms. Thompson is under the weather tonight, so we hope she's feeling better soon.
Good evening.
Hi, Commissioner Smith. We just reconvened for the public hearings. Ms. Thompson is not feeling well, so Mr. Downey will be here making the report or conducting the public hearings for us. Okay.
Good evening and Merry Christmas, Madam Chair, members of the board. As Madam Chair indicated, I'm going to be presenting the two public hearings for you tonight. These are both rezoning cases. The first item is an application from Sandra Fleming, Judy Leslie, James Clifton, and Chris Lane. It is a request to rezone residential agricultural highway commercial. The location is 3309 and 3313 Hawkins Avenue. Tax parcels include 9644-49, 2269, 9644-49, and 2604. The applicants are requesting to rezone two adjoining properties at 3309 and 3313 Hawkins Avenue, most familiar across from the pharmaceutical plant. These are two properties that currently have single-family houses. I believe they're vacant. More or less, the intent here, the adjoining zoning to the north is a highway commercial. It's a former site of the Campbell's Country Store. To the south is the Northview self-storage units. As I mentioned, across is the Wyeth campus. And then behind is basically residential agricultural, and it's the site of the Northview Optimist Club. You do have a copy of the map on the wall here for reference. If you're just curious, it's behind the attorney here. Under the analysis, the applicant is seeking to rezone the properties jointly in order to market them for the highest and best use. The current residential agricultural, of course, is for agricultural low density. The intent is to rezone to highway commercial to allow for development in a non-residential manner. It's my understanding in talking with staff that the applicants don't have a specific use intended at this time. They're just looking to make the property more marketable. I won't go into great detail. You do have, I believe, in your packets, information about what's permitted in the highway commercial district. If you have questions, I'll certainly try to answer any that you might have about that. In terms of utilities, the lots are served by public water and private on-site septic systems. The site is basically illustrates Hawkins Avenue as a major thoroughfare and gateway. The major thoroughfares that typically serve through travel, external travel into major industrial commercial areas, such as highway commercial. There's no property, the property does not have any watersheds or floodplains. In terms of development standards per the zoning, if redeveloped, the lots would of course be required to be brought up to standards for new construction, which would include landscaping, buffering, all the things you typically see on new construction sites or sites that have been basically redeveloped. In terms of conformity with the 2020 land use plan, the site, this particular site or these two sites do not have a specified land use within the plan. In terms of conformance with other plans, the Deep River Small Area Plan lists the properties as within low to medium density residential, intended for single family with densities of 2 to 3 homes per acre. The Deep River Plan recognizes that Hawkins Avenue has a mixture of industrial, commercial, and residential development, and it notes that property along the major corridors are conducive to retail and commercial development. Of course, when considering the zoning or rezoning of any property, current development trends within the neighborhood should be continued and applied. And I'll pause there, Madam Chair, if there's any questions.
Any questions or comments?
And this is a major thoroughfare, huh?
Yes, sir, it is.
The public hearing is open to the public, and Yeah, all that would like to speak in favor of this? Anyone? Anyone to speak opposed to this project?
Madam Chair, I should have clarified. I don't believe we received any calls in opposition to this.
Okay, thank you, Marshall. Okay, all right, declare the public hearing for this closed. Okay, thank you. And the next item, Mr. Downey.
Yes, this is also a rezoning. This is a request from Mr. Wendell Johnson. It is to rezone from the current light industrial conditional zoning district, a conditional use district, to basically what is considered a general use or straightforward light industrial district. The property is at 4127 Jefferson Davis Highway. It includes tax parcels 9539 15, 9499, 9539 24, 7891, 9539 15, 2574, and 9539 15, 4482. This area under consideration consists of four tracts that total approximately 23 combined acres. The parcels have over 550 feet of frontage along Jefferson Davis Highway, or 15501 South, or US 1 South, excuse me. The properties are now formally developed as Lee Fabrics as an industrial warehouse, sales, and service facility. Existing land uses in and around the property include mostly primarily rural, residential, and agricultural, and parcels of various sizes. The areas to the north and east are RA, residential agricultural, and is a site of a tree farm. The areas to the south are zoned RA and are consist of vacant lots as well as single-family developed lots. Properties to the west and being west of US 1 are zoned residential and developed with two single-family homes. In terms of additional staff analysis, in October, the applicant contacted the staff with the indication basically they're having difficulty leasing the space. You may recall, some of the board may recall, that this property was actually zoned the conditional zoning or conditional use light industrial in 1996 for specifically, and that's a key here, for warehouse sales and service and storage trailer rental only. And let me digress there for a minute. With the conditional zoning, that means that you have in your packet a list of all the light industrial uses. In this particular case, because it's conditional zoning, it was only those uses specifically listed as what's allowed. So basically what he's attempting to do, he's wanting to rezone to remove just that narrow list of uses and do everything that's allowed in that light industrial use, if that makes sense. And then just for reference again, there is a map on the wall to give you an idea of the property. As I said, the applicant had been unable or had difficulty in leasing the property just for those uses as allowed as approved in 1996. And is seeking the general use LI to allow more flexibility in being able to lease the property. You have the information listed in your packet. I won't go into all detail unless you have specific questions about the LI district. Again, the point being is this simply he's trying to modify to allow more of the light industrial uses as opposed to the narrow list that was allowed in 1996. In terms of utilities, the property is served by public water, but it does have an on-site private septic system. The 2000 Sanford Comprehensive Transportation Plan does identify US 1 as a major corridor or major thoroughfare. The 2013, the most current DOT traffic counts show 14,000 vehicles per day passing by the site. The property does not locate within a watershed or floodplain issues. If rezoned on the site, again, similar to what we had before, would have to meet the current standards if it were to be redeveloped. In terms of the 2020 land use plan, again, the plan does not specify a specific use for this property. And then lastly, in terms of conformity with other plans, the Greenwood Small Area Plan does designate this property as within the highway commercial classification. Again, when considering the zoning of the property, current development trends in the neighborhood should be considered and applied. And again, Madam Chair, I'll pause there if there's any questions. Yes, as a matter of fact, I was getting remembered. We did have late this afternoon, I believe, and correct me if I'm wrong here, but I believe we had two calls in opposition. We had another call that was earlier in the week or earlier in the time frame that was just asking questions about it. But I do believe we did have some calls that were concerned.
What were the nature of the concerns?
I just believe that they were concerned about the expansion of the light industrial, allowing some of the uses in that LI beyond what was approved in 1996. And I believe they may be here tonight to speak.
Okay. Okay, any more questions for Marshall? No? Okay. open the public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak in favor?
Good evening. I'm Wendell Johnson, and I'm the person that has requested this rezoning. And I'm just seeking your understanding in my situation there. I've been there for 22 years running a fabric, wholesale fabric business. And as I can well assure you, the fabric business is no longer in Lee County. And it's left me with a nice 25,000 square foot warehouse that I'm looking to do something with, and I'm looking to broaden my horizons as the capabilities of being able to lease that property. And if you have any questions, I'd be more than happy to answer.
I do want to apologize to you for us playing phone tag.
Not a problem.
But he was victim to my schedule this weekend. Okay. But thank you for coming tonight, Mr. Johnson. Thank you. Okay, anyone to speak in opposition of this?
Mr. Johnson.
Yes.
Do you have any plans for anything to go into?
I don't have any immediate plans.
Okay.
I'm just looking to, with this conditional use, it's tied me specifically to.
Tied your hands?
Yeah.
Okay.
And I'm trying to kind of open the window to it, if I may.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
My question is.
What?
Of Barbara Fox, I said 41.
Okay, if you can come up to the mic, because we've got folks listening.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
I live at 4116 Jefferson Davis Highway. I want to know what he's going to build it and how would it affect us in the residential area? And will our tax base go up?
Okay. I'm sorry.
Barbara Ann Fox is your name?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
I'll try to address part of that. It's in terms of if you were to develop or redevelop, of course, they would have to meet design standards depending on what type of construction it was. It depends on, in the Unified Development Arts, we have different tiers. So if it's a minor addition, you don't have to do as much. If you do more work, you have to do more improvements. My understanding and staff talking with Mr. Johnson is at this time there's really not any new construction. It's more or less the intent, I think, is to occupy the existing structure with a new tenant. So then it would just be a matter of a change of use, and that would typically be more or less meeting building codes. Again, zoning would check that, and we would be involved, but depending on what would be required, it may not require as much in terms of external improvements and things like that.
Do you want to answer a second question,
yeah.
too? I'm sorry, what was it?
You're talking about your land value, is
yes.
that correct?
That would be probably beyond my expertise. I mean, I can tell you typically it's already light industrial. So, I mean, I don't think you're going to see much change there, but I'll probably defer to the tax office.
Xiao, would you come?
I would just say it would depend on the use that would occur on the site.
See if she wants those documents.
Yeah,
you know, whether it would have an impact on any of the sites around it. And you'd have to go through that list item by item and determine that. I don't see it. It's, you know. It's already there, so.
Probably not adversely.
Well, and it's on a heavy, you know, heavily traveled highway already.
Yeah. It's on that corridor.
Does that help,
Ms. Fox?
Does that help?
Did you hear Commissioner Reeves? Commissioner Reeves, I think, said that it would not be, he didn't think any changes.
I didn't think it would do any more adverse to your property than it already has. It's been there since 96.
It had minor traffic at that time. I'm
yeah.
just thinking about if he builds something else, the traffic get have more traffic right there in our residential area as well.
Maybe I'm missing it. Isn't this on
it's on Jefferson.
It's on
Jefferson.
I think she's concerned that if he changes the use that's in the building, it may generate, if it's more of a retail nature or, I guess, high volume commercial or high volume industrial use, that it would change that.
That's a good point. And what would happen in that situation, again, when they came in for the change of use, if they wanted to change something significantly, depending on what they would do, they may would have to go check with DOT to get a new driveway permit, and that may impact.
And you'd be notified of that.
Right. But my understanding, again, is the intent is to put something similar to what he had before.
Thank you. Okay. Anyone else in opposition? Okay. Declare this public hearing closed. Thank you. Okay, thank you, members of the planning board, members of the community, applicants. Have a Merry Christmas.
Same to you.
Considering what we went through on this coal ash thing, have you taken a look at the floodplain area out in Coleman?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, okay.
I sent him something on the.
Thank you. Thank you.
What happened?
It changed a little bit. Okay. Hi, Ms. Minter. Monthly financial report.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening.
Good evening.
You should have on page 109, starting there, the monthly financial report for the month of November 2014. You will see that we are still running behind on tax revenues compared to the same time frame last year. I have checked in the shell, and we still have some relatively large taxpayers that paid early last year that have not paid yet at this time. We have discussed the major one, and she said they will be contacting them if we do not receive something soon, just to make sure we don't have a mishap of timing or something getting crossed. Okay. As far as expenditures go, we should be at around 41.67%. We still have a few departments that are exceeding those targets. As you will see there, the governing body is exceeding. That's still due to dues paid to the association and Triangle J and Bright. Strategic services is exceeding due to the upgrades of some software. Elections is over their target right now because of the November election with all the additional staff that is brought in to run the election. You'll see that start balancing out over the next few months. IT is exceeding due to maintenance contracts and completion of projects. General services is over due to maintenance contracts and completions of projects also. Juvenile detention is running over due to a large bill that we received for September 2014. I have followed up and looked over the other months that we have paid so far, and those seem to be more in line with each other. So we're hoping that September was a bad month and that things will level out. I will continue to monitor this line item though and bring a budget amendment to you if we decide there is one needed. I'll be glad to entertain any questions on the financial report if there are any. If not, I have passed out the sales tax distribution for the most recent distribution we received, which was for the month of September 2014. If you look at that first page, you will see that we received a total of $913,739.44, which is the highest month we've had so far this year. And you can see we're running roughly right around 25% in most categories, a little under on Article 39 and a little under on Article 42. That is just the distribution and fees and the hold harmless amounts that we get held against for the city, hold harmless amounts. If you look on the second page, you'll see how we are doing historically compared to our previous numbers. We're seeing on average about a 4% growth, which I'm tickled to see and hope we'll continue to see on into the rest of the fiscal year. And if you look at us countywide, which is the last page, you will see overall the growth is anywhere from 5 to 6%. And of course the city, as we discussed previously, got a part of that because of their change in their tax rate when we lowered ours and stuff. So I'd be glad to entertain any questions on that report if there are any.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Very good job.
Yeah. All righty. Budget amendment, Ms. Minter?
Yes, you have a budget amendment in front of you that will take $200,000 from our fund balance and appropriate it into professional services, legal, and admin budget. for potential fees related to legal services for the Colon Road coal ash site.
Discussion? Questions? This is a budget. This is not a, like a...
Not a blank check.
That's right.
I'm not worried about that. There'll be another discussion.
Okay.
Move to approve.
All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Okay, motion passes. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lisa.
All right.
Yes, ma'am. My manager's report starts on page 116. The first item is the Sanley Park fire update. For the new commissioners, the county is insured through the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners Risk Management Pool for property and casualty claims. And the association's insurance adjusters and fire investigators have finished their investigations. We're waiting on the final report. I have a meeting in Raleigh tomorrow, and I'm going to leave a little early and meet with them to get the final report. We went ahead and asked the association to look at the claim in two ways. One was to just repair the building just as it was before the fire, and also to take a look at if we were to consider demolishing the building and how they would pay that claim out. If we demolish the building, they view the value of the claim a little bit differently. It's based on value of the building plus depreciation and how much of the fire actually destroyed the building. So they're going to hopefully show me that calculation tomorrow afternoon. The building is located in a floodplain. It is not ADA compliant. There are some building code issues with the building as it stands, which if the value of what has to be repaired is greater than half of the building, we would have to address all those issues. ADA, we'd also have to remove asbestos. The list was going longer and longer and longer. And that's why I have to meet with the adjusters to find out exactly how much money we can get and whether it's more beneficial to just go ahead and fix the building or to move it a nature center type thing to a different part of the park and get it out of the floodplain. So I don't have that tonight. I was hoping I would have it for you tonight, but we did not get that Friday. We'll get it Tuesday. So that's just my update there. We have a lot of matters coming up after the first of the year. The budget kickoff workshop and capital improvement plan kickoff typically are around the 1st of February. We'd like for the board to start considering dates for that. The Community College Board of Trustees has requested a joint meeting with the board to discuss the bonds. Just let you know, I've already met with the Facilities Committee and talked to them about it. I think there were some, ideas about how they would go about the renovation projects and try to spread them out and that kind of stuff. And for those that weren't here a few years ago, when that happened, the last time we issued bonds, we had to pay arbitrage penalties because they didn't do the renovations work fast enough. So when you issue bonds, the bondholders are expecting you to do the project and move on. So,
John,
yes, sir.
Have they hired an architect yet?
They're out for RFQs right now. To look at architects for the projects. So they have not. It's one of the reasons they'd like to meet with us jointly. Other joint meetings to consider after the first of the year with the Board of Education, City of Sanford, Town of Broadway, etc., and try to get those in February and March before we start, talking about budgeting in April and May. So it's always better to talk about non-budgeting items first before you meet with boards and talk to them about money.
Let's go back to the CCCC.
Yes, sir.
I would like for you, the board, to consider us getting a recommendation from the manager as to how we ought to proceed on these bonds. so that we hopefully will be on the same page when if we do have a joint meeting.
I can do that at the January 5th meeting.
Fine.
I'm already ready to get that to you.
Okay.
I'd be glad to do that and then schedule a meeting with them shortly thereafter.
All right.
One of the things that I'd like to mention, I noticed what the president had asked for, but in light of some of our scheduling concerns, if maybe we could do it on the second or the fourth Monday and meet in the Wicker Room and have maybe...
In the evening?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Early evening, maybe sandwiches or something to that effect.
right. I will get with that. You're thinking like the 12th?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I will get with him and see if he can get with his board and arrange the 12th.
Or the...
12th.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's shoot for that and see.
All right.
Does that sound okay with the rest of you? That okay? Okay.
And I think we do have a lot of issues in common with the city right now and the Board of Education. And I will get with the city manager and the superintendent and see when there's a time that we need to try to get together and throw out some suggested dates, keeping that Monday night theme in place. Okay. Well, I was just looking. There's several Mondays open. So
we tend to have other board meetings and commitments other days of the week. So
right. I'll try to do that.
Okay.
Legislative goals and new commissioner training. If you're interested, please let Gaynell know as soon as possible. Space is limited for the new commissioner training that's in Raleigh. There are spaces available in other places of the state, but if you want to go to the shortest distance, you need to let her know quickly. Okay. Good. I mean Chapel Hill, excuse me. It's hard for me to say Chapel Hill, but it's just a hard thing. And then you have various reports in there, and as you can see, January is a busy month. There's a lot going on. Offices are closed December 22nd through the 26th. There's also closed on just January 1st for the New Year's holiday. And then we are closed on the 19th for the Martin Luther King holiday. And we meet on a Tuesday that week, historically, instead of that Monday. So that's that. The last item I have was what we discussed in closed session on the library director. Let me get my stuff back out. For the record, an offer of employment has been offered to Susan Benning to be the new library director to replace Michael Matochik. Her current employer is the Beaufort Hyde Martin Regional Library out of Little Washington, North Carolina. She has extensive experience, and in our negotiations with her, part of her relocation is a $1,500 allowance for moving, and ask that the board approve that $1,500 for her, since I don't have that authority.
Motion to approve. Any discussion?
That's a good sign. We're getting somebody from the beach area to come to the Colash area.
She has family located in Raleigh.
Okay.
And so she's moving closer to home.
Thank you.
Somebody done a good job.
Yes, okay. Thank you to the library board, yes. Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Okay, welcome Ms. Benning to the county.
That's it for me.
Okay. All right. Commissioner comments.
Before you get to that, Madam Chairman, I think all of you got a copy of this Lee County Panthers just print out. Did all of you get a copy of that?
Maybe. I'm not sure.
I didn't put it out if you're looking at what I
okay. It's okay. We'll get copies if you need to.
Well, I'll just pass it down.
Okay.
You can look at it. I got a letter from these people. It's a little football team here in Lee County called Lee County Panthers. I think they've had an exceptional year. They're getting an opportunity to go down to Florida to play some football, and they're looking for some sponsorship. And I didn't know if this board would be interested, since the name, Lee County Panthers, and they're from Lee County, and it's all youth, that we might want to look at helping them out some. I don't know the, whether you want to do that or not, but I thought I'd pass it by you.
Can you share the, share their email address?
Yes, you can, I believe, if they, if you're trying to get them to get personal donations.
Now, their email address, correct me if I'm saying this, is LeeCountyPanthers@gmail.com? Okay. Some young people wanting to move on in football.
We get our name out in the light down in Florida, too.
That's right. Florida has a Lee County,
and
so we need to let them know that it's our Lee County.
Supporting those young men.
Okay. Commissioner's comments. Mr. Smith?
Yes, ma'am.
Do you have any comments for us tonight?
Yes, ma'am. Just wish to wish everyone a Merry Christmas. I will be ringing the bell at Lowe's Foods from 10 to 12 on Saturday if you want to help me fill it.
Okay.
And could you have the county attorney to call me when this meeting's closed?
Yes, sir. Okay. Merry Christmas, Kurt. Have safe travels home. Okay.
Yeah, please, a couple things. Did we talk about Eagle Scout thing presentation?
Yes, sir.
You working on that still?
We're still putting that list together.
Thank you. I wasn't sure how that was left. The other thing I also want to the board to keep in mind is we talked about a couple of meetings past people encouraged to volunteer. And then we had somebody volunteer, the only one that did volunteer. And then we pulled him from the board, or we're trying to pull him from the board. That kind of seems a little discouraging to me. So I just want to keep that in mind. The other thing is, we obviously discussing times of meetings. And I just wanted to point out that I had said that I had also pointed out, at work, we make things happen, and we move our schedules accordingly, and I don't have an issue with that. I can do that, being a private businessman. Others may not, but I had asked why we moved times, and it says we didn't have, it didn't matter about people showing up, didn't change much from 6 o'clock to 4 o'clock, but when we have important meetings, such as public hearings, they're at 6 o'clock. When we have coal ash meeting, we have it at 7 o'clock. So when we want the biggest participation, we have them at later hours. So it appears that we're choosing what's important for the public, and the overall meeting doesn't seem to be important. I just want to throw that out there. Other than that, Merry Christmas. And I didn't congratulate the new gentleman on the board. I wasn't here at our first meeting, so congratulations. My pleasure. And Merry Christmas. Thank you.
Thank you. I just want to wish everyone a safe and Merry Christmas, and that's it.
Same sentiment to everyone. I hope you have a very Merry Christmas and a Happy Holiday and a good start to the new year. And thank you to the citizens for allowing me the opportunity to serve.
And let me just say this before she move on. I, Ms. Collins, the next time she brings us some jam, bring some bread.
But we're a spoon for our supper, right? Yeah.
Usually right about now.
Yeah, I just want to wish everyone a Merry Christmas, our fellow commissioners, and all our employees here with the county, and a very happy new year.
All the same.
Okay, I'm going to We'll run through this really quickly. As Ms. Lee and I have discussed, we have been overwhelmed by some coal ash issues and didn't have this printed out. We will get this to you in the next day or two. Our schedule for board and committee meetings for the upcoming year. The first name that I read out will be the lead commissioner. The second name will be the alternate.
You're just going to get that printed out and it's mailed
to us? Right. Okay. We'll email it. But I, for public information, I'll go through these really quickly. For the ADA committee, I'll be taking that committee, as well as the Board of Education liaison with Dr. Frazier as the alternate. BRAC will be Mr. Odom with myself as the alternate. Chamber of Commerce, Dr. Frazier with myself as the alternate. Downtown Sanford, Dr. Frazier with myself as the alternate. The New Partnership for Prosperity, Mr. Odom, Mr. Sloan is the alternate. Environmental Affairs Board, Mr. Sloan and Dr. Connect. Fire Advisory Board, Mr. Smith and Mr. Sloan. Health Board, Dr. Connect, Mr. Reeves. Johnston Lee Harnett, Community Action, Dr. Frazier, Mr. Sloan. The Joint Planning Commission, myself and Mr. Sloan. Juvenile Crime Prevention, Dr. Connect, if it will work out for your schedule, with Mr. Reeves. And we can talk about that at a later date. Lee County Partnership for Children, myself with Mr. Odom as an alternate. Library Board of Trustees, Dr. Frazier and Mr. Odom. Emergency Planning Commission, Mr. Sloan and myself. Parks and Rec, Dr. Frazier and Mr. Smith. Rest Home, Nursing Home Advisory Board, Mr. Reeves and Mr. Odom. TARPO, Rural Planning Transportation Planning Organization, Mr. Odom and Dr. Connect. Senior Services Advisory Board, Dr. Frazier and myself. Social Services Board, myself and Dr. Connect. Sand Hills Mental Health Board, Mr. Smith and Dr. Connect. Transportation Advisory Board, or COLTS, Mr. Reeves and Dr. Frazier. And Triangle J Council of Government, Mr. Sloan and myself. And then the interlocal committee that we have, myself, Dr. Frazier, and Mr. Sloan. So we'll be getting that out along with the meeting schedules. I tried to be mindful of people's schedules and times that they would be able to be available when I set these up. But again, if there's some questions or concerns, get back to me. Mr. Frumpton and I are going to be meeting in Chatham County tomorrow. And we will keep you updated as much as we can, as fast as we can, as things are moving quickly. We had a good tour today at the Duke Energy retired coal plant on Corinth Road. And meeting with some Duke folks today as well. So just getting more information and learning as we go along. But everyone have a very safe and Merry Christmas and Happy New Year.
Madam Chair, I have a motion.
Yes, sir.
That we adjourn.
Yes, sir. All those in favor say aye.
Before we go, I want to ask the clerk, one of the things that happened a couple of weeks ago is that the district attorney's office has a new neighborhood crime program. We ought to invite someone to come down and
explain
that program to us.
Because we missed that because we had our public hearing. Right. Same. Agreed. Thank you.
Is the district attorney's crime prevention program?
It's called SAFE.
Okay, we've got a motion to adjourn. All those in favor say aye. Aye. Opposed? No, we are adjourned.
You know, it's my wife.